What is up, and welcome to Chapter 25 of Traditions and Encounters, the Americas and Oceania. Finally, we talk about the American continent. So the Spanish Caribbean, it basically began with Christopher Columbus coming into the Caribbean islands thinking he reached India, where in reality he had just reached this new continent that no one had discovered before, except indigenous peoples. And one of these were the Taino. So the Taino were the first the Columbus people encountered, and these people, they lived in small villages under the authority of a chief. And basically, they showed little resistance to European visitors such as Columbus, and they're actually really friendly people. So he built the fort of Santo Domingo on what is today the island of Dominican Republic in Haiti. And this was basically the new capital of the Spanish Caribbean. So the new conquistadors, I guess, from Spain, they conscripted these natives to mine gold and sort of to work for them with very little pay. The Spanish created encomiendas, which were basically land grants to Spanish settlers. And these settlers would then have total control over local people, sort of like making these local people slaves. So it was like a really bad thing. Also, these Taino populations experienced brutal abuses, and also, as mentioned last time, smallpox severely decimated these people. So at the time, there was a lot of conquest, of which the biggest were of Mexico and Peru. So Mexico and Peru were really up for grabs because two big civilizations in America, the Aztec and the Inca, lived there, and they were really wealthy and much more complex than the Caribbean societies that Columbus had first encountered. So one conquistador, Hernan Cortes, along with 450 men, conquered the Aztec Empire around Mexico City in the year 1519. There were many problems that led to this. For one, there was tribal resentment against the Mexica, so the surrounding tribes did not like the Aztecs, who made them pay tributes and stuff. Also, epidemic diseases like smallpox also aided the Spanish efforts, so these really helped bring down the Aztec Empire. A third thing is there was this one girl named Malinche, more betterly known, or known to the Spanish, as Doña Marina, and basically she was this interpreter that was captured in the year 1519 on the coast where Cortes had first arrived. And because she was a good interpreter and advisor and had knowledge of many languages in the Americas, she was able to help communicate between the Aztec and Cortes, and eventually what brought the fall of the Aztecs. So some people view her as a traitor to the natives at this time, but simply she was probably just doing her job. And the crazy thing is that she even bore a son to Cortes. Pizarro, on the other hand, he led a small band of men, once again, to topple the Inca Empire in Peru. So this was done about 20 or 10 years rather later, in 1532, and the problems of the Inca were many. Primarily, there were internal problems, so the Inca government was starting to fall apart at this time. Also, smallpox, just like with the Aztec, contributed heavily to the decline of these native peoples, because they simply didn't have this resistance to this European disease. And by 1540, Spanish forces had controlled all of the former Inca Empire. And the thing is, these native empires really were no match for the European guns, germs, and steel, so that's basically what allowed Europeans to conquer these native empires. In fact, the Aztec thought that Cortes was a god when he first arrived, because he wore all white, and he traveled on a ship with white sails, so it looked kind of like an angel bringing him here. And just years before, the king, actually, and other people had this vision of the Aztec gods arriving soon. So they thought Cortes, because he was like white, obviously he was from Europe, he would come and save them, but in reality, it was really to take them away. Iberian empires in America. So Iberia is that peninsula off Western Europe that contains the country of Spain and Portugal. So basically, all the lands conquered by Spain and Portugal in the Americas. So Spanish colonial administration was formalized after the conquest by these conquistadors. There were administrative centers in Mexico and Peru, and they were governed by viceroys, who were kind of like generals or government leaders in charge of these areas. And viceroys were reviewed by audiencias, which were basically courts appointed by the king to sort of rule over them. So it's kind of like checks and balances a little bit. But ultimately, viceroys had sweeping powers within jurisdictions, so they're kind of like the king of the new lands they conquered. So since Portugal and Spain were both predominantly Catholic, and they listened to the Holy Roman Empire's Pope, they started to have some battles and conflicts over the lands they both conquered. So to solve this, the Pope issued the Treaty of Tordesillas, and it basically drew this line that said all lands east of this line in the world belong to Portugal, and all territories west of this land belong to Spain. And this land just so happened to cut through modern-day Brazil. And as a result of this, Spain got everything west of Brazil, so basically the entire South America, Central America, and many parts of modern-day America, while Portugal got Brazil and all the territories east, so like their, of course, big trading ports over in the Pacific Ocean, which they had conquered many years before, with Prince Henry the Navigator and others. So the Portuguese king granted Brazil to nobles, and much like the Spanish, there was a governor to oversee this process. There were sugar plantations by the mid-16th century, and this was really a big deal and a big trade for Portugal. And now moving to colonial American society. So In America, there were still European-style societies and cities, and indigenous culture even persisted in rural areas because the Europeans didn't really invade the natives' lands like the Spanish did. But there was more exploitation of the New World than settlement, and many times they were just trying to plunder the resources and get out. But still, many Iberian migrants were able to settle in the Americas during this time period. North America, primarily. So it was the foundation of colonies on the East Coast and small exploration of the West Coast. So this is kind of like the origins of America. So France and England came to North America first. They came seeking fur, fish, and trade routes in the early 17th century for their home countries, but settlements soon forced them to abandon some pursuits because they suffered from isolation. There were really no one there, no one living here besides the natives. And there were food shortages, of course, because they were out in the wild. They had to hunt for their food. So colonial government was a little bit different too. North American colonies, they were controlled by private investors, so little royal backing. So the governments and the king and queen of these countries in North America didn't really back them. So what happened was rich people would pile their money together, spread the risk, and try to invest in this new journey to America. So royal authority and royal governors also existed, but there were also institutions of self-government primarily in these areas. So relations with indigenous peoples. Settler farms, the people who settled in North America, they interrupted the migrations of the indigenous people, so that was bad. And this is the beginning of conflict with natives. Also, settlers seized lands and then justified them with treaties later on. And natives didn't like this, so they retaliated with raids on farms and villages. And the biggest thing is that the native population dropped drastically with this new European arrival. Primarily, they dropped because of all these new diseases that were coming. Socially, there was the formation of multicultural societies. So with the Spanish and Portuguese coming, mestizo societies emerged. And this was basically a new social hierarchy at the time. So people of varied ancestry started to live together because as different people came, many times inadvertently, children would be born out of these relationships. And so new categories of race would form. And this was really like the caste system over in India. So mestizo were the children of Spanish and Portuguese men and native women. So these people were half European, half natives. And the society of Brazil, but other South American countries as well, were more thoroughly mixed. So they had a combination of other races. So as we said, mestizos were Europeans and the natives. There were also mulattoes. Mulattoes were basically the mix between African slaves who were brought over and Europeans. And finally, there were Zambos. Zambos were the lowest of the lowest. And they were basically a mix between the African slaves and the Native Americans. And these are really important words to know because in the social hierarchy of this time, it's a really important distinction that you can make. And it frequently appears in essays as well. As another note, it's really good to compare this to the caste system of India because this is basically a perfect example of social hierarchy not seen in many other places. So the social and racial hierarchy was typically as follows. There were whites, basically peninsulars and Creole lows. And basically, peninsulars were like the pure white. They came from Europe, they were born in Europe, and they ruled these colonies. And the Criollos were basically the children of these peninsulars. So although they were white, they were born over in the Americas. So as a result, they weren't deemed like as pure because they weren't actually born in Europe, although they were 100% European as well. So these people, they owned the land and held the power. Following them was mixed races, so these were mestizos and Zambos, and they were oppressed and they performed much of the manual labor. Finally, Africans and natives who weren't in these mixed races because they basically had no European blood in them were at the bottom and frequently discriminated against. North America, so there was a greater gender balance among settlers, and there were lots of instances of marriage among their own group. So there wasn't much mixing in North America. And there was a greater gender balance because here there were some settlers who came over. It wasn't just the male conquistadors who were trying to gain new lands. So relationships occurred as well. So French traders and native women, they created like their own mestizo, and that was the Matisse. The English didn't really like interracial marriage. So everything you learn about Pocahontas is kind of like different. So that was less of the case, but sometimes it did happen. And the biggest thing was cultural borrowing or like cultural adaptations of like plants, crops, and deerskin clothes. So the Americans and other people who lived here primarily shared some of their ways of life with the Europeans who came. And these Europeans, if they wanted to survive in the Americas, they had to adapt these customs, such as new clothes. And with that, they were able to survive. Economically, a big deal was mining and agriculture. So in the Spanish Empire, silver was more plentiful than gold. In fact, there was a whole mountain of it. And it was basically the basis of Spain's New World wealth. So it made Spain really wealthy from this. Conquistadors, they melted the Aztec and Inca gold artifacts once they were able to conquer these empires. And there were two major sites of mining. The most famous one is Potosi in Peru. This was basically a whole mountain of silver. And there was lots of exploitation that went on here. So silver was really significant globally. 1/5 of all silver mined went to the Spanish treasury. So finally, Spain was like loaded. And with the silver, it was able to pay for Spain's military and bureaucracy and really fund their expeditions out east as well. So this silver went to Europe and then eventually to Asia in exchange for the luxury trade goods such as silk and spices. Over in the Americas, there were also large private estates known as haciendas, and these were basically the basis of Spanish-American production. So people, especially the locals, they were conscripted to create and farm food for Europeans and other people. And eventually, the abusive encomienda system, so this is a really big deal, important word to know. It was basically the modern plantation system, but by the Spanish, it replaced the repartimiento system that was before. And eventually, even free laborers came over to America and started to farm the lands, and that was basically the growth of Americas. But the biggest thing was encomienda system basically started, it conscripted natives, eventually it would move on to African slavery and create the whole slavery debate we see later on in history. Sugar and slavery, it was big in Portuguese Brazil, so the Portuguese basically entirely depended on sugar. Sugar was big for them, and basically the sugar planters were the nobility at the time. And because they needed to produce so much sugar, it was only economical if they were able to get a free labor force, and this came from slavery. So the natives, they were not cultivators of this, so they resisted farm labor and really were not much good to the Portuguese. Smallpox and measles had also killed much of the indigenous population. So as a result, Europeans imported African slaves to produce all this cane and sugar production. So this is really like the first instance of African slavery in the Americas. But unfortunately, there was a high death rate and low birth rate, so more people died than babies were born. And as a result, slaves weren't able to replenish, and the Europeans had to ship over more slaves. It was so bad that roughly every ton of sugar cost one human life, so there was a big human toll as well in this trade for wealth. Fur traders and settlers in North America, so this is primarily the French and the English at this time, the fur trade was very profitable, and natives trapped often because they had already done it before for the Europeans. But with all this over-trapping, there were problems, so environmentally, many species started to become endangered. Also, there were conflicts between natives because they were competing for these skins with the Europeans that really wanted to get a ton of skins because it was like a fashion icon. It was like the supreme of Europe back then. European settler cultivators, they also planted cash crops, so this was big, primarily tobacco, rice, indigo, and later cotton as well, and this threatened native societies who really didn't rely on cash crops at all. Also, the indentured labor started to come over. Basically, people would agree to work a certain number of years for a master in order to get a free passage in America, and after they were able to own their own land. But eventually, this was unprofitable for owners, and these owners turned to African slaves by the late 17th century. So it wasn't, slave labor wasn't really prominent at this time because there weren't many labor-intensive crops, but eventually it would be. And New England merchants, they had a big slave trade, and they were really big on distilling rum, so that was primarily their trade. Socially, Christianity and native religions in the Americas grew as well. So the Spanish, as I said before, they practiced Catholicism mainly, so mission schools and churches established. Some missionaries recorded the languages and traditions of native people, although many of those were lost. And some native religions survived, but the Catholic Church were able to get many converts, and eventually this turned out to become syncretism, such as the Virgin of Guadalupe. It became a national symbol. It was basically this virgin that was sort of combined with the Virgin Mary and is still very popular in syncretic Catholicism over in the Americas today. The French and English missions, they weren't as successful. They were really more about the trade, not totally about conversion and Christianity, but they did do some of it. And the French missionaries, they were able to get more success than the English. They didn't find spices and little farmland, so they didn't really like it or had much interest for it. But then, of course, British Captain James Cook, as we learn, he was able to explore East Australia, and eventually he convinced England, or people figured out that England could establish a penal colony in Australia to store the overflow of convicts who were in English prisons at the time. So Australia is really probably just a nation of former convicted criminals, as many people see it. And basically that was how Australia was founded. Ultimately, free settlers outnumbered these convicts, and that's the Australia we know as today. So the Spanish, they continued. They were able to travel to many other places in the Pacific for trade as well. But the biggest impact on the Pacific Islanders from these regular visitors and trade was that they were wiped out in some instances. For example, there were misunderstandings and skirmishes, and the Europeans with their more powerful weapons took over. Whalers started to visit them a lot, and that wasn't good for their culture or society either. And missionaries, merchants, and planters followed as well. And in some cases, the diseases they brought really wiped out their civilization and left the rest of them defenseless against these new European invaders. So in conclusion, this has been Chapter 25, New Worlds, the Americas and Oceania. Thanks so much for watching, and hope to see you in the next one.